Yeah.
There you go. All right. Thank you for coming tonight. My name is Andrea, and I helped set up the show for Jerry. This is Jerry Bradley.
Hi, Jerry.
First, I'd like to thank the sponsors for tonight's show. Judy Fair Spaulding, Paul and Chris Myers, the Swap Sheet, and Aletha Benson. Jerry is one of those rare and unique people who's both left brain and right brain work tremendously well. So he is able to take his engineering skills and his analytical skills, combine with his creativity, and come up with these fabulous objects. So I'm going to let Jerry start telling y'all about himself. Okay? You ready?
Sure.
Okay.
Well, with that kind of introduction, I'm not sure what I'm going to say. Okay, first I'm going to start my timer. Okay. First, I'd like to say a little something about the title of my exhibit, Forms from Within. When Rosie told me to, you know, send me all the paperwork to fill out to do this presentation, she said, well, you know, what's the title of your exhibit? And I never really thought about that. So that was the hardest thing on the form to fill out, was come up with the title. So I thought, I came up with Forms from Within. And I think that kind of tells the story in kind of two or three different levels. First of all, when you're going through the process of figuring out what a sculpture is going to look like, you kind of come up with the form or the shape in your head, and obviously that's from within you and that sort of thing. And then of course, there's a classic definition of sculpture is, you know, it's taking and creating a form from within a piece of material. You know, it's the old classic story about, well, someone asked the sculptor, well, how do you make a sculpture of an elephant out of a rock? And they said, well, you just look at the rock and take away all the parts that aren't the elephant, and that's how you do it. So again, that's another way of looking at forms from within. And then when people see your work, then they come away with some sort of impressions. You know, they go through an internal process within themselves, and they form an opinion, and it's either good or bad. And you know, this is America, and you know, you may like it, you may not. So this is what I do, and so here we go. Let's see if this works. Well, Andrea already stole my thunder. I'm going to thank everyone, but she didn't thank everyone. So, in addition to the people that she thanked, obviously the museum staff, Jane Burbeck Larson for putting this thing, you know, having the museum and running it here is really great. Rosie Lackey, who unfortunately can't be here because she has an injury. Andrea was a real help in putting all this together. Tony Wilkins helped set this stuff up. I have a real appreciation for what it takes to put one of these things on now. It's a lot different being on this side of the food bar. Lois Hinman did all of the little labels here, and I appreciate that. Carroll Evans and Alan Woodman and Steve Benson spent hours this afternoon doing all the lighting, so if you don't like it, complain to Carroll. And of course the sponsors, I think Andrea already thanked them. And of course I'd like to thank all my friends and family.
Oh.
I don't have that many friends, but I have a pretty good one. But a lot of them are here, and so that's really great. And last, but certainly not least, I want to thank Sandy, my wife. There's been many, many, many evenings over the last several months that I didn't go to the movie with her, and I didn't watch that TV show with her, and I didn't fix things around the house because I was out in the garage making what you see here. And I'm very fortunate to have Sandy as a wife because she is very understanding, and I think I owe her, but I think she will collect later. Okay, well, a little bit about me. Andrew said the left brain, right brain thing, and yeah, I do have an engineering background. I'm a mechanical engineer by training, but I'm now a bureaucrat. during the day, and then at night, I put my cape on and go in the garage and try to be an artist. And about 10 years ago, well, we moved into our house. It's been a little bit over 10 years ago, and I had this huge garage. It's like 1,400 square foot. And I thought, you can never possibly fill up a garage that big. Well, I wish I would have made it twice as big. So I decided I wanted to build a computer control router because, I don't know, because I'm an engineer, I guess. And so I made one out of an old graphing machine and a Dremel tool. You know, I got parts at the thrift shop and I put this thing together and it sort of worked. And I had fun with it, but it wasn't very good. So about 5 years ago, I built the version on steroids, which has a two horsepower router, and it's quite about 100 times faster than the old one was. So anyway, so that's kind of my background. I don't want to bore you too much with that. A little bit about this router that I use, not for all of the parts, but a lot of the parts, or at least a lot of the processes. This just is a simple diagram showing how it works. I got a pointer here, high tech. The router is here. It can go up and down. That's called the Z-axis. It go back and forth this way. That's the number. X-axis and go back and forth this way. This direction is the Y-axis, and whatever you want to carve goes in this area. So. And sometimes there's also another axis where it rotates. And the router, rather than using the normal router bits that you normally see, I use, actually end up using end mills that are used for machining metals. And I usually use carbide just because I'm lazy. They don't get dull very quickly and they stay the same shape and they last pretty much forever. So they're pretty handy. I mentioned the Dremel tool. There's the Dremel tool. Here's the green drafting machine that I got from thrift shop. It was probably somewhere out on base, 20 years ago. And here was a sign I was doing for the High Desert Child Abuse Prevention Council. And this thing was so slow that it burnt the wood. So it actually made it very muddy. It was a combination wood burning machine. But I learned a lot playing with that.
Yeah.
You can see down here, there's a few conventional carving tools for, when things didn't go right. This is the newer machine, and it's still homebrewed. As you can see, I spent $20 at the thrift shop on a metal desk, and then I proceeded to put $2,000 in the hardware software. But again, here's the router, here's the Z-axis, here's the X-axis, going back and forth this way, and that's the Y-axis. And then I have this little thing here. I can actually rotate things. In fact, here's a piece being turned. And that's a different way of making things. And kind of the amazing thing about this is that this is just a standard PC buried in the sawdust back here. And this is a standard keyboard, and this is a standard mouse. And the dust doesn't seem to affect it at all. Every once in a while, I blow it out or vacuum it out, but this particular computer has been running for about 5 years with essentially no maintenance. I had to put a new drive on it, but CD-ROM drive, but other than that, it's been fine. I just wanted to put a video in here just because I could. In fact, that was one of the problems this afternoon. It wasn't working. Anyway, here's a video showing the router working. See the keyboard. This is the what I'm making here. Actually, these are scrap pieces of corium. See, there's a DuPont corium. See, there's a commercial there. But these are scrap pieces that I glued together, and I'm machining a spherical surface, and it's about 3 foot in diameter. So it gives you an idea of the scale. And it takes a while. I mean, it took several hours to cut that spherical surface out of that piece of corium, multiple pieces of corium glued together. And that mold is what I use to shape the COSO shield in the back of the room, the dark blue piece with the light. It's right there. I don't know if I won't find anybody there. So, anyway, I don't think you want to see a whole lot more of this. Okay, well, so I built this thing, and I said, gee, this is really neat. I can make stuff, and I can make almost anything, so what should I make? And what can you do with this? Well, and of course, what you can do is almost anything you can think of. So it's just another tool. You know, if you if you give a palette knife to a chimpanzee, you know, he'll probably hurt himself and won't do anything. But if you give a palette knife to a great artist, you know, they can create some beautiful things. So, I'm somewhere between that great artist and the chimpanzee. The kind of things you can do is, you know, do simple 2D cutouts, you can do engraving, you can do inlays, you can do three-dimensional carvings, and you can do lithopaints, which is what these guys are over here, which are carvings where well, I'll call them that later. It's in here. Obviously, two-dimensional cutouts, it's just tracing around a flat object. And oftentimes, that's the starting point for more complex pieces. That's your favorite clock, isn't it? Yes. But here, this is a clock that's above our fireplace, which I made using a machine. But it looks like bronze, weathered bronze, but it's really quality British plywood. So, but that was just a simple cutout, but it's about 3 foot in diameter. This is a kinetic sculpture that is hanging on my son's wall in Las Vegas. That's using that out. These are some oak leaves that were cut out and inlaid into a white oak quilt stand, which I believe is in Germany, if I remember correctly. Is that right, Nate?
That's right.
The other thing you can do is engraving. I primarily only use engraving in my work putting dates and sometimes signatures and that sort of thing on the bottom of some pieces, so not always. But there are sort of things that I do and I have used it for. This is a wedding gift for Lisa and Kurt Kassenstein. I think they're still married. I'm pretty sure they are. That's not a song they were still happy. But at any rate, that's an example of engraving. Here's an award that I did for one of our employees that retired. Fortunately, we don't have too many people that retired, so I haven't done too many of these. But, and then here's, this is actually the model of this piece over here, the engraving on it. So I need an idea of what you can do with engraving. Inlaying is where you cut away a portion of the base material and then insert another object into that cavity. That's usually a different material or texture or whatever. So I use the router to cut a shallow pocket in the base of the space object and then glue the other piece in place, and sometimes I have to use a hammer. And then take the hammer marks out, I usually sand the surface down to get it to all the same. And here's some inlays. This piece is in Ohio. It's based on a Celtic design, the triple spirals, and that's black walnut inlaid in hash. So, this is a tribute board. It's here in Ridgecrest, Al Alvarado near for him. Oh no, what do I do? Wireless configuration. I think I want to cancel all that. But at any rate, this is a tribute board where I inlaid a variety of different kinds of hardwoods into this curly maple, so it's a beautiful piece. I hope they all did too. This piece is in Reno. It's black walnut with an Italian soapstone rim, and then the inlays here are Italian soapstone and merle wood. And this is one of my favorite pieces, but unfortunately I don't own it anymore. But the owner is very happy, and there's another bowl with a similar rim depth here. This is another inlay I did. This is in with actually the mirrors. My son is a homeless man, and so for his birthday I built him this guitar. It's a kit, so it was pretty easy to make a guitar. But I customized it by inlaying Opus's name a couple places, and then this Opus played the air guitar. So here, those are examples of inlays. Thermal coating. A lot of the pieces you see around the room are made of corian. Corian is the countertop material that you see at Home Depot and other places. And it's basically a thermoplastic. And so as it heats up, it will soften. And so you can cut shapes out of it, heat it up, bend it, and then glue it back down, and it freezes in that position that it's cooled down to. So I have this great pair of bright red silicone rubber gloves. I look like this giant lobster, but they're really great for handling the hot corium because you get up to about 350 degrees, so it's obviously something you want to hold on to for very long. But it's also very shock resistant because you can dip it in water or spray water on it if it doesn't shatter. So that's a good thing. Here's my high-tech equipment for a thermal probe. These are two of the largest riddles that you can buy at Walmart. And of course they had the lips that, you know, contain the grease, so I didn't, hopefully it wasn't going to get any grease out of my parts. So I ground all that off and obviously didn't do a very neat job, but it's very functional. So I just lay corian across those. If it's big enough to require two of them, I use both of them. If I don't need one, I use one. And if I guess if I make build something really big, I can go buy a third griddle. And then these are just silicone rubber pads that I lay over to help hold the heat in. And then this is one of my birthday presents for my son. It's an infrared thermometer for checking the temperature. And so I just set the temperature on each of these dials, and the recipe is laid on there for 15 minutes, and then it's ready for thermal form, maybe 20. Judy Fairspaulding may recognize this piece. This is Sherman the Shaman. He's about 6 foot tall, and he was actually eight pieces that I had to glue together because my raw material was sink cutouts from the countertop process, and so this guy was an eight sink cutout. So there he is cut out flat, and then here he is in my backyard, and so I can take a picture of him, and I somehow just successfully got it to her backyard and got around it, and he's withstood, I guess, 70-mile-an-hour winds and almost a year in the sun, so hopefully he'll last a little bit longer. I hope he stays because I gave her a guarantee that he's all right. I think she remembers that too.
He's doing great. He hasn't moved an inch.
Okay. And here's another example of thermoforming. This is that thermal mold here. Oops.
Oh, I like that.
And then this is the kinetic sculpture back in the corner there. The two spiral arms there with thermoforming. So anyway, that gives you some idea of weight. And you can actually get some very amazing flowing lines, actually fairly simply. By eating it and stretching like that. So, anyway, okay, 3D carving. This is the harder stuff and the stuff that's a little bit more complicated. Usually what I do is I try to figure out what I'm going to make beforehand. Usually do some sort of paper sketch, figure out what the stock's going to look like, that I'm going to cut it out of, that sort of thing. Then I use a piece of software called Rhinoceros, or Rhino for short. And it's a commercial piece of software that's used for designing airplanes, cars, boats, things that have smooth flowing forms, basically complex 3D shapes. It's actually a very sophisticated piece of software, but and I would use a small percentage of its capabilities. Then I have another piece of software, again, it's a commercial piece of software called Visual Build that takes that shape and develops tool paths, tells the tool where to go to cut this thing out. Of course, it needs a little adult supervision, but it does a lot of hard work. And then once I get the tool paths, I load them into another piece of software called MaxNC, which is what runs the router. And if it's a really complex object, then I have to figure out, you know, I may have to cut it out in multiple pieces and glue it together. So some of the more complicated pieces, some of these vases are multi-piece, so I had to cut multiple pieces and put them together. In fact, you'll see some of that here. There's a sketch. So if you already show my app, that's my sketch. But anyway, this was an example I did for the Desert Artist League. I sketched up some little cubes. Here it is modeled in rhinoceros. You can see there's, you know, top view, front views, right view, you know, just like you had in graphing class in high school. Then I move it over into this other software called Visual Mill. You can see the same basic shape there. And this is the software that creates the tool paths. Oh no.
And paid your bills a little bit.
So far, so too embarrassing. At any rate, so this software, like I say, generates the tool paths. The other thing that's kind of neat is it actually models the machining process. So like, here's the cutting tool. This piece has had a rough cut. Here it is, starting the final cut. And so you can actually see your mistakes, you know, on the screen rather than, you know, ruining a $50 piece of wood or something. So this is a really good thing because it allows you to catch some stupid mistakes, or most of them before you get actually made. And here's the piece actually being made. In fact, I've got it here if anybody wants to see this little set of cubes. The interesting thing that I find kind of intriguing, I know it makes sense, but you can get very sharp corners with a quarter-inch diameter radius built bit. It doesn't seem to make sense that you do that, but you actually can, and these are pretty sharp corners here on the cubes. At least that impressed me. And then, you know, here's the finished part in Visual Mill, and then there it is. Where the fuzz had been taken off. This is the instructions that the software puts out. Bunch of X's and Y's and Z's. But just to make those cubes, it would take 2,308.5 by 11 sheets of paper if you actually printed it out. Needless to say, I didn't do that. So there are several trees that I appreciate you not printing that out. But the point is that there's a whole lot of information there that you really don't see, but it's. The computer needs all those little small moves to do what it needs to do. Here are some examples of 3D objects that are carved. This is a shell made out of a figured maple on a burl base. This is a cedar from Colorado. The person in the audience probably recognizes this. Person wanted a mortar and pestle, so I made this, and he says it's too pretty to use now. But anyway, hard maple, this was made on the router. Actually, the base, it was easier to form this by hand than it was to flip it over and write another piece of software, so I just formed that by hand. And this piece here, the pestle, the smasher part was made actually using that fourth axis that I used to make the cubes. And then there's an aspen base over here by the door. This was it being machined. You can see that here's the interior of each half, and you can see the knots here on the back. But this was the piece being rough cut, and I think here's the piece finished. This is aspen wood with the red knots, and then this is red wood. This is one of my favorite pieces. Lithium veins. I started talking about lithium veins. That's what these objects over here are. Lithium vein is loosely translated from the Greek. It means image, and so those of you who've had Greek probably are laughing right now, but that's my understanding of the translation. They were popular back in France in the 1800s. They were handmade. And then later in Japan, in the early 1900s, they made tea sets using lithium veins. Like I say, they were hand carved in clay, and then they were fired into porcelain, and then they would put a candle or a lantern behind them. Although when you illuminate them from the back, those areas that are thin are brighter, and those areas that are thick are darker. So you get, like, this is bottle leg, here's June leg, this is five fingers. With smoke from the fire, not the most recent fire, but the previous fire. And the sodium is back over there. But anyway, so what I do is I take a digitized photograph, and I will usually run it through Adobe Photoshop to adjust the contrast and the size and that sort of thing to get it the way I want it. Fred Harson understands Photoshop much better than I do, but he does more impressive things than I do in Photoshop. But at any rate, I get it to the point where I get it the way I want it, put that into Rhino, and it, I made this three-dimensional surface, which is what you see here, that's sampled every 10,000ths of an inch, and then I transfer that into Visual Mill and create tool paths. And that, it's amazing, you can get really fine detail with a 16-inch diameter ball in there. And I've made some actually smaller ones, used smaller in those, but 16 actually works pretty well. Anyway, this is kind of boring with going on, but anyway, here's the process that I use. Usually use the spiral pattern because if there's any variations, the spiral doesn't show up quite as bad as a horizontal lines for some reason. And it takes about 6 hours to make an 8x10 image, so it takes a lot of computer time. Fortunately, I can be, you know, sweeping up the garage, which I usually don't do, but I can be designing something else. So at least I don't have to be there at the game for the 6 hours, but I do go out and check it pretty regularly. Then when I pull out the router, I usually do some, you know, break all the sharp edges and sand it. And sometimes I glue a sand on it. Sometimes I thermoform it into a curve, as these are, so that I don't have to extend it. And there's the my bogey fingers. Then there are a few pieces here. That's basically my presentation. There are a few pieces here I just want to make a few comments about. Hope you enjoy some of the names I've made for the come up with some of the pieces. This one is Species Seaborn from a little shop of horror, I think it was, but brains. At any rate, I don't know why, but when they had this image, that the vision that I would make a flower out of corn. And so I came up with this sort of cowboy kind of design. And, you know, like a mad scientist, I went out and made this thing. And then I had to get a pot big enough to put it in. And I had to cast it in some casting plaster-like stuff. Anyway, when I got all done, the thing weighs over 40 pounds. It's one heck of a paperweight than anything. So that's kind of the, I don't know, that's this piece up here, I call it specific rim. I don't know. It's made from wood over the specific rim. But anyway, it's coal with soapstone. I guess the interesting thing that I kind of found is coal wood. But when we were in Hawaii about 3 or 4 years ago, we were driving down the highway and I saw this sign that said hardwoods in it. So the car made a sudden light. And we turned in there and they had some beautiful, beautiful wood there. And I asked them, I said, do you guys ship to the States? And they said, yeah, we ship every day. I said, well, God, it's kind of expensive shipping by air. He says, no, we use UPS ground. And he was serious. I thought he was going about that. He was serious. But what they do, because it's so expensive to ship to Hawaii, they actually charge ground rates, even though obviously it goes by air. Because I ordered about a 100-pound box of wood there, and I think it was on a Saturday, and Monday it was at Postal Services Plus, you know, and I picked it up. So it was pretty amazing. But anyway, coa wood is a protected species. It's very expensive wood. You can only harvest coa wood from hurricane-down trees. So when there are big hurricanes, the price of coa goes down. And when there aren't hurricanes, it goes up. And then there are also licensed coa plantations. But because it's a hardwood, it takes, you know, many years to grow. This piece over here, I just wanted to point out, the rim is kind of unique in that it's, well, first of all, the coa wood is sort of like tiger's eye. It's sort of iridescent. And to take advantage of that, I've oriented the grain of the wood so it runs radially out from the center. Of course, that required taking little pieces of coa wood and sanding them at an angle and gluing them on. But it was worth it. This piece is kind of interesting for a couple reasons. One, because it's made out of rope, I guess. And the other thing is that these little things that look like Klingon writing, those are actually brands from the old California missions. And beside the piece over there on the wall, there's a little list of what the different brands are. I picked the brands that were more interesting to look at. And some, like San Francisco, was just an F. It was pretty boring, so I didn't use that. But at any rate, there's a number of different brands there. It's kind of interesting. This piece, our neighbors probably recognize this because we were out picking up bullets in the desert. And they brought their wine glasses out and saying,
Jerry, what are you doing?
And so I was afraid they'd already called the asylum to come pick me up and stay there and they're picking me up. But I said, honestly, I'm going to use these at peace hardware, so I'm glad they came and, and know that I actually did use it. But the interesting thing here is that this is made of 22, spent 22 shell casings, and there's over 1,300 of them on that array, and three 12-gauge shotgun shells there, because it just needed something considered. So. This piece, there's actually two pieces that are similar here. One of the trays, the 12 trays on the wall, is similar to this. This one is a little different in that it's footed. It has a, underneath this, you can see it, there's a foot. And then it has sort of rims that I picked out the lighter colored pieces of wood to try to create a light color there. But anyway, this is made of creosote, which is the Zanino bushes you see out in the desert here. And these are all found limbs. No creosote bushes die in the making of this product. But the interesting thing about it is that when you sand the creosote down and buff it, there's enough resin in the wood that it produces a natural finish. So the only finish on these pieces is just a little paste wax that's been put on there. And you look at that finish, you would think that it has a lack of finish on it. I talked about this piece earlier. This is also a Koso design. I love the Koso Indian or the Native Americans because they provide all these great art objects that we can copy, and there are no copyright issues, at least not on our world. So, but anyway, there are a series of designs that they don't quite understand what they were. They call them Koso shields. Well, the Kosos were never known to have ever used shields, but at any rate, they had a lot of interesting designs. So I picked this one, and I stylized it a little bit. And I thought, well, that looks a little bit like a constellation. So I used blue as the background and white, that may have been one of the early star maps. And then this piece here has got some nice wood in it, Kokomo, and this is figured maple, and then the rim is Kokomo. So I guess the thing I wanted to point out there, and it's kind of subtle, is that if you look at this piece, there's a gentle curve on this center piece. And the reason is that I cut these pieces at 45 degrees. So little extra touch you might not notice, so I'm telling you about it. This piece, Aloha E, it's Hawaiian and Canadian. Subtle, but anyway. I talked about the koa wood before, but the rim here is made by koa, out of koa, and again, I kind of oriented the grain radially, and then there's an inlay of the koa wood in the center. And then this wood here is a material called Paraland from Canada. It's made out of little pieces of fur and pine that are pressed and glued together. It's really made for structural beams. In fact, these are scraps left over from the credit union down here on Chinese Boulevard. In fact, I made a piece out of some scrap that I found at a construction site. I won't tell you where. Pat Rogers saw it. She said, "Oh, I've got tons of that stuff in my yard. I was wondering what to do with it. Why don't you come and get it?" So I have this lifetime supply of Paraland in my backyard now. Thanks to Pat Rogers. But it has just an amazing look to it that you couldn't possibly get otherwise, so it makes an interesting material. This is a first for me. This is a piece in marble from, of all places, Marble, Colorado. And this one I actually did by hand. No computer tools were used on this whatsoever. So it's sitting back in the corner as a little piece about 10 inches high. So I just wanted to let you know that I don't do everything using a computer. And I think that's it. Yep. That's it. So that's all I have to say. I'd be happy to answer any questions if they're easy. Yes, Bill.
How did you embed the shell casing?
How did I embed them?
Yes.
I bored holes that were a fixed distance underneath that curved surface using the router. And then I used super glue and hand fit each one in. And gave it a little pat.
The old hammer trick, right?
The old hammer trick, yeah. Any other questions? Yes.
Are you going to be on Titus Workshop tour again?
No, I'm not doing it this year. Because I expect to sell every piece I have.
Okay, well, it was wonderful.
So I wouldn't have any inventory.
Jerry,
yes.
Don't forget you will be at the Sierra Film Show in November.
I was about to say that, but that's exactly right. And that's when?
9, 10, 11 of November.
Of November, yes. So I will be there. Well, I have inventory, yes.
You can buy a piece. Does it have to sit here for 2 months for your exhibit?
It does.
Okay.
It does. But that's okay. It's worth the wait. Any other questions? I think there's still goodies, and hopefully there's still some wine left, so enjoy yourself. Thank you very much for coming.
Thank you.